Hey, this is Dr. K from iMedicalSchool, and today we're going to talk about infective endocarditis. Just to highlight the important points, anytime you see this light bulb in this presentation, it means the material is highly tested, and in the words of one of my medical school professors, know that. So let's start off, as usual, by asking what is infective endocarditis? Well, infective endocarditis is a microbial infection of the heart endocardium. The heart consists of three layers of tissue. The outermost layer is the epicardium, then the myocardium, and finally the innermost layer is the endocardium. The endocardium tissue covers all structures within the heart, including the valves and the chordate tendineae. Just as a refresher, the valves are like a parachute that regulate the movement of blood from chamber to chamber, while the chordate tendineae are the cords that hold the parachute or valves open. Now that we know what infective endocarditis is, we need to understand what are the risk factors for infective endocarditis. Risk factors for infective endocarditis include poor dental hygiene, intravenous drug abuse, hemodialysis, long-term indwelling catheters, diabetes mellitus, and prosthetic valves. If a patient has these risk factors and is in the appropriate clinical setting, you should consider infective endocarditis. Endocarditis can be caused by many different organisms, and we will focus on the most common causes of infective endocarditis. Staphylococcus aureus is the most common cause of infective endocarditis. This is the reason why if you have a gram-positive bacteremia with cultures that are not clearing or taking a while to clear, it's important to rule out infective endocarditis as this would affect the patient's duration of IV antibiotics. Coagulase-negative staphylococcus can also cause infective endocarditis, especially within the first few months after prosthetic valve placement. Specifically, Staph lugdunensis has been shown to cause significant valvular dysfunction, frequently requiring valve replacement surgery. Streptococcus can also cause infective endocarditis. Specifically, strep mutans and sanguis has been shown to play a role in endocarditis. In addition, strep bovis can also cause infective endocarditis and is usually seen in the elderly. But remember, it is also associated with colonic lesions, so these patients need a colonoscopy in addition to treatment of their infective endocarditis. Another group of organisms is called the HACIC group. The HACIC group of organisms consists of Haemophilus, Actinobacillus, Cardiobacterium hominis, Eikenella, and Kingella. Other organisms that can cause infective endocarditis include Enterococcus, Coxiella burnetii, and fungi. Remember, infective endocarditis carries with it a significant risk for morbidity and mortality, especially if not properly recognized and treated. There are a few clinical signs and symptoms that you need to be aware of. So these signs and symptoms include fever, weight loss, fatigue, heart failure, night sweats, heart murmur, splenomegaly, which means a large spleen, skin petechiae, conjunctival hemorrhages, septic shock, Osler's nodes, splinter hemorrhages, and Janeway lesions. Osler's nodes are painful, swollen, violaceous nodules on the fleshy part of the fingers and toes. Splinter hemorrhages appear as streaks in the nail bed that appear maroon and turn black. They are due to emboli. Janeway lesions are non-tender nodules in the palms and soles. Unfortunately, infective endocarditis can have significant complications. One of these complications include paravalvular abscess and can lead to heart block and valvular dysfunction. An abscess is a collection of pus. I've seen patients who have gotten so bad with these abscesses that they've required transcutaneous pacing. In addition, with left side infective endocarditis, there's a very real possibility of stroke. In patients with stroke symptoms, persistent fevers, and a heart murmur, infective endocarditis should be considered. Since we reviewed the common organisms that cause infective endocarditis and the clinical indicators for endocarditis, how do we diagnose it? Well, like any disease, we started off with our clinical suspicion, but years of treating infective endocarditis have resulted in the modified Duke's criteria. The modified Duke's criteria include major and minor criteria to make a diagnosis of infective endocarditis. You need two major criteria, one major and three minor, or five minor criteria to make the diagnosis of infective endocarditis. Let's review these criteria. There are three major criteria. The first is laboratory evidence of infective endocarditis. If two blood cultures grow organisms known to cause infective endocarditis, or if one blood culture is positive for Coxiella burnetii, that would meet the requirement for laboratory evidence of endocarditis, especially if you have persistently positive blood cultures. The second major criteria is evidence of endocardium involvement. If you have an uncomplicated case, such as no abscess, and there's no prosthetic valve present, proceed with a transthoracic echocardiogram. A transthoracic echocardiogram is an echo or image of the heart taken by putting some gel on the chest and doing an ultrasound. In patients who have a complicated course consistent with infective endocarditis, a prosthetic valve, or where the clinical suspicion is extremely high, proceed to a transesophageal echocardiogram. A transesophageal echocardiogram, or TEE, is done by placing the ultrasound probe within the esophagus and looking at the heart. The final major criteria is having a new valvular regurgitation. Now let's move on to the minor criteria. The minor criteria include having a heart abnormality that would predispose you to infective endocarditis, such as a congenital heart defect, also intravenous drug abuse, fever, as well as vascular phenomenon are also part of the minor criteria. Vascular phenomenon include having conjunctival hemorrhages, septic pulmonary infarcts, mycotic aneurysms, Janeway lesions, and intracranial hemorrhages. Mycotic aneurysms form because the infective endocarditis affects the vessel walls, and when it causes an infection of the entire wall, this weakens the walls, and when weak, an aneurysm can form. Fourth minor criteria includes immunologic phenomena, such as glomerular nephritis, Osler's nodes, Roth spots, and rheumatoid factor. Finally, the last minor criteria is a single blood culture positive for an organism typical for endocarditis, but does not meet major criteria. Now let's talk about treatment. All treatment for infective endocarditis is based on culture susceptibilities. Generally, duration of therapy ranges from 2 to 6 weeks, depending on the organism and severity of the endocarditis. For gram-positive organisms, we need to know if the organism is susceptible to penicillin. Because if it is, then we can use nafcillin, methicillin, penicillin, or ampicillin, plus an aminoglycoside like gentamicin. If MRSA is present, then you need to think about using vancomycin plus gentamicin. Combination of a penicillin or vancomycin plus an aminoglycoside like gentamicin actually creates a synergistic effect, improving the clearance of infective endocarditis. Also note, anticoagulation has generally been considered in the past because of the fear of embolic events with infective endocarditis. But anticoagulation does not improve morbidity and mortality. It actually increases morbidity and mortality just because these patients are at high risk of bleeding because of developing mycotic aneurysms as well as intracranial hemorrhages. So do not use anticoagulation in these patients. So that was a brief review of infective endocarditis. Make sure if you like this video, share it with your friends on Facebook and Twitter. You can follow us on Twitter at iMedSchool, and also we have a new Facebook page, so follow us there. Make sure to comment, like, and subscribe. This is Dr. K, and I'll see you next time.